we're carrying on the struggle. You see, we're carrying on the struggle. And sometimes you have to do some very important things. We're getting ready to get started. We certainly hope that all of us can just put a little bit extra in our salute. Let me acknowledge Brother Michael Gray from the Guardians. Brother Michael Gray, will you please stand? And we certainly hope that your president, Brother Eric Adams, is in good health and is secure and safe, because like many of us, he's traveling on a very dangerous highway and have to sometimes face gunshots to get from point A to point B by his fellow, who? That's a big name, Helen. We don't know that name. Anyway, moving right along. We want to now rise and put our hands together for a brother that we haven't seen in some time, but we know that he is always amongst us and will always be with us. Let's put our hands together for our friend, our elder, our scholar, Dr. Yosef Ben Yochanan. Dr. Ben, let's give a warm round of applause for Dr. Ben. Glad to have him back with us. Dr. Ben, and let you know that we love you so much, Dr. Ben. I want everybody to just stand one more time and let's just give it up for Dr. Ben as he comes to the microphone. The next voice that you will hear will be our brother, Dr. Yosef Ben Yochanan. Dr. Ben.
This evening, first of all, I would like to show my appreciation for you having me here again. And there are quite a few things I would like to speak to you about. Some, or for the most part, I will be speaking about matters that took place in December and parts of January. That's December 94 and, I'm sorry, December 95 and January 96. The first starts with my group of people in which I'm associated, those who are relatives of my father, and the group among whom I was born. As you know, for years, I fought for my brothers and sisters in Ethiopia. I fought for them, unfortunately, as Hebrews of Ethiopia. It was unpopular for years fighting for African people as Jews, or as Hebrews, whatever name you prefer to use. We continued that fight for quite some time, and as brothers and sisters came along to fight, they equally went away from the fight. We were fighting against millions of dollars, multi-millions of dollars, because we were fighting Hadassah, of B'nai B'rith at all. At one time we thought we were winning, especially when European Jews were swarming to Israel. For in 1947, my people, the Beta Israel, and I don't practice it, no, go by the label any longer. There was a time when I went to the synagogue every day. I was becoming a very pious Hebrew or Jew, as you may say. That was the time when I was most stupid. And I caught myself, luckily, by a person who had nothing at all to do with Judaism. It was an experience which I'll never forget. That experience took place instead in the United States Virgin Islands of St. Croix. There were other experiences, of course, that took place in Puerto Rico, because the other side of my life, my mother's people, are primarily in the Caribbean, in Puerto Rico, St. Croix, and St. Thomas. But nevertheless, it meant having to contact the Israeli government again, and which I thought I would never have to do in my life. But for the benefit of my people, who had felt that it was time for me to withdraw from them totally when they had the Moses exploit to Israel. However, my people who remain in Ethiopia contacted me and asked if there was anything I could do. You see, we had protested to the Israeli government for quite some time. First, they had refused to accept the Beta Israel. You probably know us as Falasha, which is an insulting term. Falasha has the same meaning as nigger. Falasha means strangers, dirty, different, foreigner, anything other than an Ethiopian. And there are many, many people, those who remain in Ethiopia today, who will not tell anyone their religion or their ethnic grouping for fear of being called a Falasha. Because with that term is a certain treatment. And when I go back to Ethiopia with the group, I mention everywhere I go, because I know people are going to be angry, I am a Falasha. And it makes a lot of people angry, especially at the Rotary Club. Nevertheless, when we got notice that the Israeli government, and this is in this month, 2 months ago, when we got notice that the Israeli government was taking blood from my people in Israel, and they number over 10,000, and our people were protesting, and even to the point of a few of them committing suicide over this fact, it was important that I got in touch with the embassy. I worked with the embassy over there. I made contact with the embassy here. And again, I had trouble and have trouble with the income tax. I knew it would happen, because it always happened whenever I have a situation that deals with the Israeli government or any Jewish group here. That's why I don't speak to Jewish synagogues. I know that I would have trouble. So again, the few pittance that I had in the bank, the income tax came and took it. And I am not going to fight for $2,000 to go up and down and to ask them, please give me back $2,000. So they took that without consideration or even my family. So I said, let it go. I don't have the trouble to go to the bank anymore. Because I know I am not going to stop. I get a little older, of course, but now I'm getting a little stronger because I got a new fight to wage. So tonight I am going to speak a little about African people and religion. You see, I'm living in Egypt. You cannot avoid the issue of religion. You live under religious tyranny in one sense, every minute of the day, every day of the year, because you have the consideration that you must deal with religion anywhere you go within that culture. And that isn't Egypt alone. And it is not in the Muslim society alone. It is wherever religion has a power. And religion has power everywhere.
All right.
If you think religion doesn't have power, then you go and ask DuPont, who just got arrested the other day. You hear people there standing up and saying, Mr. DuPont, here, this man supposed to have killed another man with a gun. But you thought that the police killed the man and he was issuing the order because they were calling him Mr. and he was saying nothing at all to them. And why? Because money and God are one in this culture. It may be difficult for you to understand it. And you may feel offended because someone will get up and say that money and God are one. As a matter of fact, they are one, and when broken down in two, God comes second and money comes first. Though they say, and the money, in God we trust. No one worries about God. When you steal a dollar bill, they worry about Washington. So what happened constantly in this struggle, having to stay in Egypt and then fight a situation in Israel for a group of people coming who have come from Ethiopia is the most wicked problem. So as we started to fight, and now I'm fighting for privileged Hebrews. The ones that I am fighting for are ones who could help themselves to the extent and capability that dollars would give a penny. These are those who went there without aid from the Israeli government, who went there with their own money, who went there first class. They flew first class because they traveled first class. They happened to be the privileged group of the quote-unquote falashas who did not need the courtesy of the Israeli government. They are supposed to be the representative of the Hebrew people from Africa in Israel. And what did they do? They allow this blood taking to take place. They are the ones who went and notified their people that they should go to take this blood because the people themselves had no desire to go and take the blood. The second thing was, why did they have to take the blood at all? If you do not want their blood, why take their blood? Because these little parasites, from members of my family included, they went and asked the Israelis to take the blood. And the Israelis were afraid to say no because they were afraid of the adverse propaganda they thought would hit the streets of the world. That adverse propaganda did hit the streets of the world because they could not have any place large enough to take that blood and keep it when hundreds upon hundreds of my people would come there and give their blood daily. They had to throw away the blood in front of all of the fellashas who were coming day by day. And that protest was to follow. I would go to Ethiopia 3 days after the last group that came there in December. We would leave Egypt and go to Ethiopia. I went to Ethiopia having walking pneumonia, not known, because I felt that the pressures there, by virtue of the height in which I was causing my deficiency in oxygen. And it continued to get worse and worse and worse until I left and went back to Egypt and then came down, had to be in bed with pneumonia for 1 week. But working for this thing, we further find that everyone out of Gondar was moved. Not a single Hebrew is left on any village in Gondar. There is only one village existing in all of Ethiopia. Colonel Mengistu and his friends, they all sacked the Hebrews. They took $30 million from Hadassah, which came by way of the United States government treasury, to support the removal of the Hebrew people from Ethiopia. Put them in the hands of the Israelis, who had no definite work for them but to be peons. And you hear this rabbi from Chicago talking about slavery in Sudan. I don't know nothing about Mauritania, so I am not going to speak about it one way or the other. I don't have any late information. I haven't kept up with any late information. But I know Sudan because I go there constantly. But these people are in slave condition in Israel, but none radio station, no newspaper, not a single Jew or peon blacks join in to condemn Israel for slavery. And I don't want anybody to tell me that they're surprised at me, because in the Torah there are sections where Judaism backs slavery and practiced slavery. You don't have to have Dr. Jeffries about slavery among Jews. In the book of Numbers, you have a section called the ordinances. It says, and now these are the ordinances. When the Jews stole, the saints in the Torah dealing with the Ten Commandments, taking those basically essential ones and call them commandments, they took the 32 others and call them ordinances. And it is in the ordinances they made it clear that Judaism will be involved in slavery, because when you buy an Hebrew slave, you must bring him to the doorpost and bore his ear. It's written there, right there in the Torah. If you can't read it in Hebrew or Aramaic, get somebody to translate it into English. And there are conditions for the treatment of Jewish slaves as against foreign slaves, people who are non-Jews. And let me get this straight about it. If you want to be Jewish tomorrow, I could make arrangement for you to become Jewish. Rabbi Parrish will make you a Jew. All you got to do is apply. He turned you down 3 times. After the third time, he got to take you. and put you through the training to be a young Jew, or no more Jewess, but a Jew. After you finish that ritual and you pass a test to prove that you are now kosher, they have to take you to a ceremony, sing and dance and get drunk over your health. But I remember when we were telling our people to avoid this charade. In 1947, when the people of Ethiopia filed for consent to return, for the power of remain to go to Israel and to be accepted as such, the Israeli cabinet took the application, and up to the day, that's in 1947, and 2 years ago, when the last group of Hebrews from Ethiopia arrived in Israel, up to that date, the Israeli had not acted upon the request. They allowed that, and constantly each year, they would table it. Yet every year, Jews came from Europe, from the Soviet Union, where they knew nothing at all but Judaism. Communism. All right. From all over the world, places where there were no Judaism being practiced. Kashim Jews from India came, who looked like any other Indian. And those are the only Indians I know, people from India. I've never seen a West Indian. I was looking for one the other day, and I found one. And all those different places, we applied to the United Nations on the basis that the United Nations was responsible for Israel in 1947, when Harry S. Truman appealed to the nations of the United Nations for recognition of Israel after the Balfour Declaration and the other double cross against the Arabs. So there, I had my work cut out for me. But nevertheless, we went and we saw Lalibela again. But again, Lalibela, though it is very important to see if you had not seen it, and it is surely good to renew your acquaintance with it, Lalibela has now become a refuge for all the fascists of the world. The worthless dog called Selassie, and I know a lot of you mad, so get mad and keep mad. All right. But Selassie, who brought Italian workers, listen, let me repeat that. Haile Selassie, who was driven out of Ethiopia by the fascists Mussolini, Pope Pius, and Victor Emmanuel. He went back after chasing those Italians out, hired them to be scab labor against Ethiopians, Ethiopian artists, placed them to work in Lalibela, in the 20 temples dug into the wall, to do the artwork where they painted over Ethiopian paintings. And now they have not painted, because they cannot paint Ethiopians, obviously. But now there are all kinds of painted cloth pictures of a European they call Jesus the Christ. When they have not done that, they have posters standing against the wall with similar type Jesuses coming from Europe, each of them supposed to be a gift from a European to the Ethiopian Christian people. Worse yet, they have painted new devils. But you should see the devil. You would have no difficulty in recognizing him because he looked like you. And every temple you go into now, there is now a new black devil. And when you ask the priest, what about this mess in here? The priest will tell you, yes, I know. Yes, I understand. Many people have asked me about it, but we can't get rid of it. They are gifts. I said, there are laws in Ethiopia against dangerous drugs, aren't they? He said, yes, sir. And we carry it out to the T. I said, there are laws in Ethiopia against dangerous guns. He said, yes, and we carry it out to the T. Equally dangerous knives. Yes. I said, how come there are no laws against this dangerous act in Ethiopia? There was no response to that, more than it came from the goodness of the Italian people. I said, what goodness can you find in which Italian people about Ethiopians? But then I should not have had to ask the question. When you look on the street, or when you look in the hotels, and you look at the wives of the Italians in Ethiopia, you see your daughter walking down the street with a cracker Guinea's child. I know that they're going to say that is discriminatory words. They've called me nigger for a long time, and I am not complaining. That's the way they feel about me. This is the way I feel about them. And I'm going to say it another time, and another time, and as many times as I need to say it. We had this struggle, and I thought that I was dealing with it over there and it would be over. But when I came, as soon as I got off the plane, and I had taken 1 week after the group had returned, they had been stuck at the airport, you know that, 2 and 3 days, depending on the individual where they were going. But as I came in the airport, past the political end of my entry, and coming to the economical end of my entry, customs, I was immediately asked what I thought about the 1 million men march. I said I didn't think of it because I'm not marching anywhere. I can't afford to use my good shoes I paid money for to walk like a jackass. I know a lot of you mad because you've been there. If I was curious and want to know what it was for, I wasn't going. I wouldn't wait till the next day to see it in the newspaper. Since I was neither curious nor concerned, because common sense told me, why should I pay certain groups of black folks my money to march for to repent for something I haven't done? So I told a young gentleman who showed some concern over my concern. He wanted to know, well, Dr. Ben, what are you going to do about it now? Are you going to have any lectures about it? I said, no, I don't have time to waste. Well, aren't you going to lecture? Yes, I got a lecture coming up next week. And I did go to Washington, D.C. But the issue is, I noticed something very specific about the Million Day March. Number one, there was no leadership of Africans born outside of the United States. There was leadership of, and anytime I see this woman, it boils my inner side. Because I don't see how in the name of anything she could represent black women. Black women refuse to tell her where to go. She's worse than Michael Jackson is a man. I am talking about the poet laureate. The one who have four divorces with four crackers. And then, and she played a major part in the Million Day March. Why doesn't Simpson have the same privilege? He only had one. She had four. Why should I go there to pay penitence? For what? What have I done to black people that I need to go in front of white people to show them that I am paying penitence to my black woman? If I am paying penitence to my black woman, it will be in front of her, her family, and her friends who are equally black like her. You mean to tell me that I got to go to a white bus company, a white airline company, and then pay them, and some of the buses don't show up anyhow, to go to Washington, D.C., for the most part, pay a white restaurant, pay a white almost everything, to get down downtown Washington, way behind the speakers, and listen to Karenga, listen to Bob Law tell me how it is to be a good religious person, what kind of food I can't eat and could eat. What is it about them? What qualities do they have to tell me how to treat black women? I know how to treat black women. There isn't one black woman to say I ever touch her body unless it's to caress it, never to injure it. So what am I going to repent to her for? If I go any place, it's to praise her, not to repent. I ask again, who is keeping the money? I said, it's got to be some kind of money. They were collecting monies before the march. And somebody should have the money, and I am expecting on radio, TV, or something, an accounting of what happened with the money. The income and the disbursement of fund. That's any good gathering, any good organization will give a report. Whether I got to go to the report after I go to Gaddafi or not, there's a report needed. And since the march has been so long, and the accountants haven't yet finished collecting, it must be that they haven't finished, because no report comes to anyone. All right. Then it would be time if I neglected to go the first time and should go to the second one. Then I can't go to the second one because there's no reason to go since I realized there'll be no accounting. Now I am being told there is a mini, one for each state. So here's the second part of it. And I ask the question again, who is going to be in charge of the money for this? Nobody has any answer. So I said, well, I've got to find a new way. I looked at pictures on the TV, and I thought that the African nationalists would have had a prominent place in the march. Right. I expected to see pictures of Malcolm, Marcus Garvey, Hamilton, all these different people everywhere. Didn't see them. Probably they were hidden from me. And I couldn't see too well. I'm getting up there. There is no accounting there. So thus I say, it is best I do what I have to do. Avoid it, avoid major comments about it, and accept reports, and do what I've always done. Go to the toilet when it comes to me, and do what I have to do. One has to realize, of late, there are individuals who constantly, even when I'm not here, I was in Egypt a month and a half, and then it almost been 2 months. I return and I hear, when I listen to WLIB, when I listen to WBAI, when I listen to WRRL, and every one of them, people have to defend me. For what? If I'm not here and I'm not doing anything, why do I need defense? And I certainly can defend myself with my tongue the way it is. But the major problem that people have with me is my attitude towards religion, and particularly Islam. I don't know why people have that. It is strange. The same set of people who have argument with me with Islam forgot that while they jab up their mouth about Islam, that I did 2 years of voluntarily teaching at Al-Azhar University in Cairo. And if they can find an education center for Islam bigger or better than that, let them tell me and tell other people who have worked with Islam. If they're angry with me because I deal with the history of my people and how my people suffered under the jihads of Islam, and they don't want me to tell my people what happened during the jihads of the past and the jihads that are going on now. If they want me to speak gravely about Gaddafi and forget Chad, if they want me to speak great about any leader and forget that African leaders who are not Muslim, and even those who are Muslim, suffer under the hands of Muslims. That doesn't mean that we have a holiday under Christian leadership or Jewish leadership. We suffer under every sucker that isn't an African. And we should fight that from now, yesterday, and today, and tomorrow, and consistently find nothing but a fight to protect our women and our children. There is no way that I'm going to stand there and realize that it is Islam and the Arab hordes invading Northeast Africa with the Bani Salim group, Torah, people will call tribe. I would just call it unit. With Muhammad coming in, talking about his Ethiopian mother, his Ethiopian grandmother from his mother's side. If they're going to tell me that the treatment of my sister in Northwest Africa, whose son, who fought the Arabs, but let her son enter. I am talking about Tariq. Enter Islam to protect her people and died on the battlefield against the Arabs while her son in the meantime making the transition to Islam. She couldn't do it because she was a Manchian. And she felt that the Manchian had everything she needed for her own religious purpose. And thus, she allowed her son to become the leader of Islam into Hispania, today called and then called Spain. It was in Hispania, because then Portugal was part of that, and southern France was part of that. But we, as African people, had gone there before. That's why it's so important to know your history. We had gone there before with Alexander. I don't mean Alexander the Great. We had gone there showing to the world the first concept of mechanized warfare. When we use the elephants. We had gone there under General Hannibal Barker, along with his brother Hannibal Barker and his brother Hamilcare Barker. We had gone there and fought for every inch of the way until our general reached the gates, literally, of Rome, and would have gone into Rome weren't it the problem that we have, Simpsonitis. Hamilcare Barker had to have him some white meat. And when he was to be going to get arms to bring to his brother to fight the last bastion, he was killed in a whole house. And his brother had to flee for his life to return to Carthage. So we knew then, as we know now, we are not fooled by a prayer to Allah, no more than a prayer to Jesus, no more than a prayer to Jehovah. We can find some God in Nigeria, South Africa, Ethiopia, Egypt, any place. We can find some black God there or a goddess and pray to her. Why it's so difficult to pray to the woman you sleep in bed with? You're praying to a white cracker woman anyhow. So you can pray to a black woman. You want a black baby to loan and put a big thing around the head and pray to it? I could find you a black baby and find you a black artist and draw a black picture. If you don't know where you could get one. We have to deal with reality. We cannot say constantly, every day, we were slaves under the white man. Who the hell in here doesn't know that you were a slave under the white man? Do I need, or do you need, to hear me, or I hear you, constantly tell me I was slave under the white man? Was? Did you say was? I heard people going on radio condemning slavery in Sudan and someplace else. Why not condemn slavery in New York? Are they saying that the conditions in New York does not amount to slavery? Is it because we are the best dressed up slaves? Is it because we live in the best slave house, some of us? Oh, what conditions do they desire to call slavery? This morning, though it was snowing, I looked out the window before I came downstairs, and I noticed there were a number of people with a garbage pail, and they weren't taking the pail to throw it in a dump truck. They took the garbage pail to give it a massage. A massage looking for liquid in cans and bottles so that they could put that in their stomach regardless of how many days they were in that can. Are you saying to me that there are as much homeless people in Cairo as New York? And Cairo has 18 million population. New York only have 11 to 12 million population. Oh, is it that we could only see things we desire to see? I heard not one of you or anyone protesting the good treatment DuPont had. Nobody. The newspaper doesn't know what to say about it. As a matter of fact, they can't speak about Tyson. Simpson anymore. The thunder for Simpson is gone. So now he will be able to get Barbieri, but understood, even Barbieri is out now. He catch so much hell, he's gone back home to the black wife. She had to let her black husband go for the black ex-husband. Things are getting mighty bad. And now, something new has happened recently. I turned to see, I was feeling rather moody the other night, and I turned the TV station and I noticed there was music celebration in America. And there were two fools in charge of the podium. One with two women earring in his ear. I don't know what he had in his behind, but I know he had two women's earring in his ear. And that is supposed to say something to me, and it conveyed one thing, a faggot. No, it may not be. It may not be. But what two long earrings convey to your good friend and partner is that, since it doesn't look like a woman, it does look like a man, and I presume it is a man. But now we come to the sad affair of cousin, brother, I don't know what it is, Michael Jackson. He didn't show for the award. He knew that four times his name was called, and they give him the last one. He got something for something. He is no fool after all. He know that Hollywood, the record industry, which is predominantly Jewish, Oh, I shouldn't say that. That's anti-Semitic. Excuse me for the anti-Semitic comment. But I got to work because the next issue of the magazine coming from B'nai B'rith, I want to move up from the 14th page to the 3rd page at least. So let me find another anti-Semitic. I don't like Jews who steal no more than African people who steal, no more than Irish who steal. Excuse the anti-Semitic remark. As I was saying, now that Presley's daughter will have enough money from Michael, I think Jackson is the name, it will make it much better for her now when eating her pork chops. There's nothing wrong with pork chops now, it's just my special food. Because you might think that I'm blasting it. I'm not blasting pork chops. There are a lot of things I could blast besides pork chops, like chicken. But as I was saying, I would marry a woman, but there are no black women who are going to marry me for 3 days, or 3 weeks, or 3 months, and pay me a few million dollars. I'm good, but not that good. So I have to take another route to get some money to do some books. Let me touch on another matter. You know, I'm doing a book on Egypt, no, I go the wrong way, on Ethiopia, Sudan, and Egypt. Pretty well underway. And what I'm trying to do is tie up, make you able to see without any difficulty the free transformation of African people from Central East Africa down to the Great Sea, which you call the Mediterranean Sea, to show you your error insane. I am a Nubian, and you are not equally an Egyptian or a Sudanese. Why aren't you an Egyptian, a Sudanese, and or a Nubian? Well, the Nubian look like me more so than anybody else. Are you saying that if a man come and rape my mother, and my mother had 3 children, one looked like me, one a little darker, and one a little lighter, they are of 3 different races? If you are not saying that, then it's about time you stop the nonsense. Along the Nile, the White Nile, which joins with the Blue Nile, the White Nile out of Uganda, the Blue Nile out of Ethiopia, which joins in Khartoum, running farther north, joins with the Atbara River in Atbara, Sudan, and flowing to Nubia into Egypt, down into the Mediterranean. Before the coming of the first foreigners, that body of water on both sides was occupied by African people that looked like us. Whether they called themselves Egyptians, Nubians, and or Ethiopians or Aksumites. I don't know, I guess I will never see it stop. But for some reason, it's like saying that you see a jet black woman in here with pointed nose, thin lips. Isn't she an Egyptian? Isn't she a Nubian? Isn't she an Ethiopian? Does she have to have a nose like a tunnel? And a lip like souse? When are we going to stop letting the European set our physical standard for us? Mr. Blyden said it long ago. He said it on receiving the presidency of the College of Liberia. He says that the African woman has no standards in her beauty to compare herself with the European. She is whatever she is, and she is the one to decide what she is. And I'm going to continue to deal with my brothers and my sisters as Nubian, Egyptians, Ethiopians, and whatnot. Or to go to the indigenous name. Sorry. Dealing with where they came from originally. Buganda Kingdom, now called Uganda. The Buganda Kingdom, which had for the first time the name of Penwet. I have said this before, but you continually say it, that people are coming to Egypt back and forth and putting down death instead of instructions of value, bringing the racist, contemptuous information they conjugate here and bringing it back home. All in the process of trying to make more money. Let us act as the teachers we are supposed to be. Because brothers and sisters in Uganda, brothers and sisters in Ethiopia, Somalia, and elsewhere cannot be fooled anymore, if they were ever fooled at all, any time. They are not in the condition they are because they were fooled. They are in the condition they are because they no longer control the weapons of freedom. But if we continue to lie to ourselves and to try to please the men in the White House and elsewhere, then we will continue to make distinction between ourselves. It is as if I come in this audience and say, anything lighter than me would be an Egyptian. Anything dark like me is a Nubian. And if you're darker than me, you got to go to South Africa. No, the terms conjugated by European to place on me is correct for him, and he will expect me to follow it. I will follow only if I desire to, not because he wants to. It It is time that we understand wearing of garments and elsewhere and else is optional. We do not have to buy a particular type of garment yet. Yet. Third time, yet. But as long as we do not have to buy a particular kind of garment, and we can appreciate the weather playing on our bodies, we should understand that styles designed by faggots down at 14th Street, 7th Avenue, faggots dined weekly by the scores, should not determine how our women are going to look on the street. You should design, you should help your woman, and she has the control of what she will wear, but you should help her to find material as well as the design to suit the curvature of her body. Style does not make you a woman. You make the style, not the style make you. You are satisfying the man you sleep in bed with. And as long as he is satisfied and you are satisfied, to hell with 14th Street and Paris and Venice and anywhere else they have set up and prostitute our women into looking like bare-ass naked funkies. It is getting beyond. You mean to tell me that if I'm sitting on a TV and they are showing me a woman in a bank where money is being transacted, I have to see in the crack of her behind, in a bathing suit or a dress that's cut away, in order to say that's a good bank? What in the world? Does a drawers falling with a dog biting it and a woman falling in a manhole has to do with anything dealing with human decency? It shows you. And if you have a child, especially a teenage daughter, and you can't not control, but you can't lead that daughter. Yes, let me put it more succinctly. If you can't beat her behind, if you can't, then there's a door. Each apartment got a main door, at least one, where she can walk and not return. Because I know I had 8 daughters. I got 7 now. One passed away. And when I say in the house, and any of them mama says, do this, do that, and the other, it was going to be hell. And the whole police department would have had to come and take me to jail. But I was going to spank my daughter, spank my son, and anyone else who wanted it, not my wife, because she was a woman, a sacred goddess, a woman of integrity, a black woman, and needed no spanking. You see, I had to come to the human level. All right. Because it seems as if we see these things. I remember when I was sick the other day in Egypt and I carried the illness over there. As a matter of fact, I got so frustrated when I came back. I got frustrated because a friend, quotation marks, of a lady whom I know. And the lady said, Dr. Ben had pneumonia when he was in Egypt. So I quickly said, I carried it from America with me. The first question the friend asked the lady, do you think he got AIDS? It has gotten so that you can't even have pneumonia anymore. You have to have AIDS. But suppose I had AIDS. What will it mean? It will mean I have AIDS. It has nothing to do with how I got AIDS. But the assumption is if I had AIDS, I must have been sleeping with a dirty black woman. It couldn't be a dirty white woman because I don't sleep with white women. I'm too happy with black women. Why would we ask a stupid thing like that and keep the assumption when we know there are as much heterosexual good women getting AIDS today as there are others? Even the pink monkey and the green monkey and the Haitian and the Congolese and the Puerto Ricans and the Virgin Islander getting AIDS at the same rate of white people all over. Now we feel good. As long as Europeans getting it at the same extent in which we get it, it is now okay. You don't hear much about AIDS anymore. The other night I was to go to a funeral of a little 2.5-year-old who died of AIDS. Barely able to make 2.5. The mother died from AIDS a year ago. The father, no one know what he died from because he wasn't there to even say, it is my child. The only thing he know, he had sex maybe once, maybe twice, an umpteen time, but he wasn't there to say, I went to bed with that woman. So we don't know what he has. He might have been a minister, a rabbi. Oh yeah, they got rabbis with AIDS, ministers with AIDS. We better check the Pope. He may have. Why not? He's a man, supposedly. And he may have. That is nothing insulting or disrespectful. He may have. He may have gone to the hospital to see a young man. A fairy looking young man, very fairified. A very good looking young man. And he might have stuck himself with one of the needles on the bed by accident. So we could say that the Pope had accidental AIDS. Not willful AIDS, but accidental AIDS. It gonna kill you just the same. So you don't make a distinction be how you got the AIDS. Because even Magic Johnson now can play ball. I saw a senior hall last night. He doesn't look good. I think he need to check with Magic, where is the doctor he's using? You know, I'm going to bring it down to close. But I have to make these observations of what's going on. And I promise you, you're not going to see me on the TV and radio much. I'm going to be even less conspicuous than I am now, because I realize this is another 7-year itch. We have some 7-year itch that takes place when we change stream. We got some brothers who are capitalists one day,
all right,
communists one day,
all right,
Marxian socialists the other day, and I don't know the third day. It is now the period of entrepreneurs. And everybody's entrepreneuring to the other one. It was like the Depression when everybody was selling apple to the other one. Some had twin apples, homosexual apples, twin apples and other kind of apples. So I have to have no apple because I do not know how to sing in a new way. I'm an old man, and that you can't teach old people new tricks. And so I've got to stay with people like Alton Maddox, who don't switch things in a new stream. You see, I can't afford to go across the bridge, much less to live across the bridge.
Right.
You see, when I talk about black people, right, I know them. I know you all.
Right.
I live with y'all, in y'all building, in y'all house, in y'all street, in y'all neighborhood called Harlem. So when I talk about Harlem and its people, I know from living practice day to day. I come out and I must buy your food. I come out and I must buy the clothes you clothes. I must meet the police you deal with. I must live your life every day. And I love it. I love it with all its bestiality that I have to meet daily. Because who else am I going to live with? Who else am I going to fall in love with? Who else am I going to let attend to me? Somebody asked me, Dr. Ben, if you get sick again, are you going back to Harlem Hospital? I said, you know someplace else? He said, but man, They cut down the staff, they cut down the this. I said, can you think of a better place to die? Can you think of dying in a nurse's hand who is black? Even a Filipino got a month of blackness in her yearly body. I said, if I die in her hands, at least there was somebody black in her. I got some guarantee that I'm going to be dying in some blackness. So why should I leave Harlem Hospital 90 feet away from me to the emergency room and go where? Manhattan North? Is that where you want me to go? Lenox Hill? Go there and die from watching white people? Go there and die from fright? I go there and got to look up in this white man and this white woman's face telling me how bad off I am? I'm going to die from that. No, let me go where they're noisy, where they use four-letter words all day long. You know, the other day, I was practicing getting my ears ready for in case I gotta go, and I start telling myself, MF, 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 MF. I had to tell myself because the Chinese friend of mine, I met a Chinese friend, he says, man, you got some beautiful people in Harlem. I said, yeah. Did you see something I didn't see? He says, yeah. They are always talking so beautifully about their father and mother. I said, what happened? He says, everybody saying, motherfucker, motherfucker, all day long. I said, there are some nice people. They never forget their mother, and they never forget their father, and they never forget the work in which they do. So I didn't ask him anymore because he might have give me the medication for that activity. My brothers and my sisters, I have a torrid schedule for the month of February and will be in and out of the city. But I need to tell you something. It is going to be rather hard for us. And at any time there is any struggle, physical and otherwise, my number is 212-281-7744. I don't have answering service. I don't have any other fanciful things. But that telephone is there because it is coming close to showdown time at the Old Corral. We will be out there, including me, including doctors who now can't find jobs, MDs, who have to hire themselves out to certain corporations because they can't afford their insurance. Especially gynecologists and others who give women health in their female areas. It is not an accident. It is planned. When America took jobs and carried it all over the world, and I'm not speaking this nonsense about you came and took our job, because I got no job to be taken. And no one can take my job. Because when I go to the job, when I used to go to the job, the man gave me a job. He knew he gave me a job because I was the cheapest at the time. So he wasn't going to give away my job. I'm already cheap. Let's deal with reality. And he didn't hire me because he loved me. He hired me because he exploited me. And I know that. You know that, so there's no need for you and I fooling ourselves. So, my brothers and my sisters, what more could I say in refreshing you? I tried to touch the various parts of my life that I must equally deal with daily. And I need to say to you, and I'm going to do this all the time, Brother Maddox, how can I come here and not speak of your wife? I presume you're still under suspension by New York State. And she hasn't said, he can't give me a fur coat anymore. She hasn't said, you can't give her a nice pair of shoes and that she got to work extra time. She hasn't made any such complaint, but smile in the presence of all of us, maintain her integrity as a woman, keep you looking for all of us to see. And I'm going to get a white nothing to compare with her. No, Brother Maddox. This goes for all the sisters in our audience. Give yourself a hand. You have taken care of every black man in this house because he could not be born without you. You have been with us, not at our side, not in our back, but there with us. You let us out on your world. You could have smothered us. You could have drowned us. You could have strangled us. But you let us come and see this daylight. You. This letter, this lecture is for you because you give birth to me, and without you, I wouldn't be. Thank you.
Right. Dr. Yosef Ben-Yakinen, Dr. Yosef Ben-Yakinen, thank you very much. Thank you very much. And we certainly want everybody to hold hands. We're getting a little bit better. There's only two or three.